Branded for Christ. I'm Bubba Miller. This is my beautiful wife, Tammy. We want to thank you for joining us via live stream today. Our Sunday service is just a glimpse of what God is doing in our ministry.
We have several classes that we offer during our Sunday services. For kids that are walking to kindergarten are our Little Sunshines. First grade to sixth grade are our BFC Ranch House kids. We would love for your kids to come get involved in learning the Word of God.
We have a phenomenal youth group led by Garrett and Michaela Aldridge. They meet each Wednesday night at 6 p.m. We would love to have your kids join us.
We have an alternative group for those students who have graduated high school. They come together and have a great time with fellowship, food, and activities.
We have an amazing married group where married couples come and meet together to grow their marriage together as well as in the Lord. If you're looking for a place to grow your marriage, we invite you to get connected with our married group here at Branded for Christ.
We have so much to offer here at Branded for Christ. If you're looking for somewhere to connect and grow in a Bible-believing church, we invite you to join us here at Branded for Christ at 5 p.m. on Sundays.
Well, service is fixing to start. I'll see you back after the service.
There's a grace for what I've been doing, and I'll be excited when God brings that next phase of my life.
Yes, and you're being obedient to Him.
That's right.
And that, I think, is the most important
thing. That's right.
I love that.
Operating on God's timing. Perfect. I want to go ahead and pray again, and then we'll get started. Father God, I just lift this message up to you, God. I pray that you can speak right through me, God, that we can hear a word that's going to mature us in you, that's going to grow us in you and help us discern your voice and your timing for what you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, today, I want to talk to y'all about timing, okay? And if any of y'all are familiar with rodeo or a lot of things in life, you know that timing is really important. And so you can pull up the video, and I want to show you a couple bronc ride videos. Okay, Cody Wright, Lunatic Fringe, maybe one of like the coolest souped up hoppers ever. You could probably literally drink a glass of tea while spurring this horse in the neck, and he's 89 points. And sometimes this is how your life with God feels. Sweet Blade.
The guy that in 2013 won Odessa, Denver, Fort Worth already this year. And Lunatic Fringe is the stud that Bobby's been talking about.
Look at this, oh my goodness. Ladies and gentlemen, he is the oldest of the bunch coming in, just barely over the age of 35. You're watching a father of five who's been the champion in Houston as well.
Cut him a check.
89 and a half points. Say it again, Bart. Say it again. 89 and a half.
The Houston champion upsets Cheyenne's apple cart. That big stud horse, and we've seen two of his babies, two of his sons and daughters, in this arena today already. But Daddy is still the guy to beat as he carries Cody Wright to a $25,000 payoff. Oh, that was amazing. Look at his toes turned out, lifting on his rein. That's what they're judging, folks. How well do you do that? And nobody does it better than Cody. Jesse Cruz will be one of the guys that congratulates him. That's world champ.
Perfect. I'm talking about, that'll make a team roper want to saddle up and spur bucking horse. That'll take Esteban out of bronc riding retirement and go win Houston. But sometimes your life with God feels a little bit more like these bronc rides, or at least mine has. Go ahead, babe. Yeah, life's good. Life's real good until horses.
We'll be right back.
Sometimes God's timing feels a little bit more like that. See, there's some times in your life where we know God is sovereign. Right? The Bible teaches us, just like Carrie Job talked about, Psalm 27:14, wait for the Lord, be strong, and take heart, wait for the Lord. Lamentations 3:25 says, the Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. And we know that, but for some reason, waiting on God's timing, trusting him enough to be obedient when things aren't going like we think they should, can be one of the hardest things for a believer to do. And oftentimes it's hard because when we're trying to wait on God, oftentimes we're trying to do the right thing. We're trying to do the right thing. We feel like we're serving God, but maybe it's just not working out like you think it is. I mean, maybe your finances aren't quite where you think that God's been serving you, but you feel like you're behind the eight ball all the time. Maybe you've been asking for a healing and you're wondering why God hasn't quite showed up. Maybe you're single, maybe you're going after a career, you haven't quite found that career that's a good fit, you haven't quite found that special person to marry yet, and you're wondering, God, I mean, I know you're going to show up, but I thought it would be by now. And I want to talk about how can we operate on God's timing, because if we're not operating on God's timing, our Christian walk and our life will look like those bronc rides of those guys getting bucked off every time. Because you just can't operate, you can't have a successful bronc ride without being in time with your bronc, and you can't have a successful Christian walk without having the patience, having the trust, being in time, in sync with the Holy Spirit. And so I want to talk about how can we operate in God's timing, and I feel like there's a pretty cool example of this in Genesis. It's in Genesis chapter 37 through 50, and it's about the story of Joseph. And a lot of us have probably heard about Joseph. How many of y'all have heard about the coat of many colors in the Bible? Coat of many colors. Okay. So you've heard about Joseph, right? You've heard about the coat of many colors. And the interesting thing about Joseph was he was at 17 years old. He got a vision from God that his family was going to bow down at his feet. He got a vision for God that God was going to use him in a big way for a big purpose at 17 years old in chapter 37. And it didn't come to pass until chapter 45, until 15 years later. And through this span, if you're familiar with Joseph and the Coat of Many Colors, you know his brothers sell him into slavery. Through that, I mean, he goes through all kinds of trials. God uses him. And there's a lot that we can learn about God's timing and what we need to know about that in this story. And so I want to unfold three things that we can take and we need to know about God's timing so that we can operate in it as we go through this story. And so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to read different parts of Joseph's story, and we're going to talk about it, and we're going to go through these three things and apply it to our life. And so if you have your Bibles, we're going to be spending most of our time in Genesis chapter 37 through 45. And I'm going to go ahead and get started and read a little bit to you. This is how the story goes. This is chapter 37, verse 2. It says, this is the account of Jacob and his family. Now you have the patriarchs of the Hebrew faith, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So you got Jacob right here. This is the account of Jacob and his family. When Joseph, which was his youngest son, was 17 years old, he often tended his father's flocks. He worked for his half-brothers, the sons of his father's wives. Jacob loved Joseph more than any of his other children because Joseph had been born to him in his old age. So one day, Jacob had a special gift made for Joseph, a beautiful robe. But his brothers hated Joseph because their father loved him more than the rest of them. They couldn't say a kind word to him. One night, Joseph had a dream. And when he told his brothers about it, they hated him even more than ever. Listen to this dream, he said. We were out in the field tying up bundles of grain. Suddenly, my bundle stood up, and your bundles all gathered around and bowed low before mine. His brothers responded, "So you think you'll be our king, do you? Do you actually think you will reign over us?" And they hated him all the more because of his dreams and the way God talked and the way he talked about them. Side note, do you know that you can have a word from God and it not be received well because if your attitude's wrong? And what I think is interesting, and I'm going to read another line. When Joseph is young, just by how the word talks about it in different commentaries, you can see as a young man, as a 17-year-old, he's getting these revelations from God. God's speaking directly to him, but he's sharing it in a way that can't be received, and it's pushing his brothers away from him. Check this out. Joseph soon had another dream, and he again told his brothers about it. "Listen, I have another dream," he said. "The sun and the moon and the 11 stars bowed low before me." And you got to realize, the sun and the moon, they would have interpreted that obviously as his parents, and the 11 stars, he had 11 brothers. So obviously, he's saying his whole family is bowing to the ground before him. But his father scolded him. "What kind of dream is that?" he asked. "Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow to the ground before you?" But while his brothers were jealous of Joseph, his fathers wondered what the dream meant. And so you have Joseph. Here he has a vision from God. He's a young man. He's serving God. Maybe that's like a lot of you. You're young. You're serving God. You're doing stuff. You're on the right path. His brothers go off to care for some sheep. And in the verses that follow, Joseph is sent to go help his brothers out. And we come to this scene where his brothers see him from far away, and they begin to plot a way to kill him and get rid of him. Check this out. Verse 18 of 37. When Joseph's brothers saw him coming, they recognized him from a distance. As he approached, they made plans to kill him. "Here comes that dreamer," they said. "Come on, let's kill him and let's throw him into one of these cisterns. We can tell our father a wild animal has eaten him. Then we'll see what becomes of his dreams." But when Reuben heard of their scheme, that's his brother, he came to Joseph's rescue. "Let's not kill him," he said. "Why should we shed any blood? Let's just throw him into this empty cistern here in the wilderness. Then he'll die without us laying a hand on him." Reuben was secretly planning to rescue Joseph and return him to his father. So when Joseph arrived, his brothers ripped off his beautiful robe he was wearing. Then they grabbed him and threw him into the cistern. Then, just as they were sitting down to eat, they looked up and saw a caravan of camels in the distance coming toward them. It was a group of Ishmaelite traders taking a load of supplies down to Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, "What will we gain by killing our brother? We'd have to cover up the crime. Instead of hurting him, let's sell him to those Ishmaelite traders. After all, he is our brother, our own flesh and blood." And his brothers agreed. So when the Ishmaelites, who were Midianite traders, came by, Joseph's brothers pulled him out of the cistern and sold them to him for 20 pieces of silver, and the traders took him to Egypt. My first point, when you're operating, what you need to know when you're operating in God's timing is that it will always test your faith. When you're operating in God's timing, when you're serving God, when you're being obedient, it will always test your faith. Just look at Joseph here. He's serving God. He's got a revelation from God. He knows God is going to use him in a huge way. He doesn't quite know how. He's being obedient to his father. He's going to help his brothers. And then all of a sudden, adversity. Then that will always happen in your life. You're going to be serving God. And then when you're waiting on God, when you're being obedient, that's like Carrie Jo, when you're 32, she's wondering, obviously when you're, you know, at that age, she's wondering, am I going to find a husband? Am I going to do certain things? There's going to be certain times in your life where you're going to come to a place where waiting on God tests your faith. And this is what we need to know about God's timing. It rarely happens how we think it should. And it rarely happens when we think it should. I mean, maybe you've been betrayed by some family members. Maybe you thought you were going to reach out to some of your family and it was just going to go great. You were going to witness to some of your family and it was going to go great. And all you got was your family turning on you and coming against you. And it didn't work like you thought it would. And you're gonna come to a place where adversity will test your faith. But I got encouragement for you. It's in James 1, verse 2. And it says, verse 2 and 3, "Dear brothers, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow." You see, if your faith was never tested, if you never ran into any trouble, we would be the weakest, wimpiest Christians. It really wouldn't even take any faith to follow God, because we would just know, shoot, if I follow God, everything that I want, how I think it's going to happen, would happen automatically. But that's not how it works with God, and that's not how it works with God's timing. And we see that you have an opportunity for joy. And we see that Joseph, he's sold into Egypt. That's not how he thought God's plan would go. And I can just imagine him going off to Egypt thinking, "God, why? I mean, I got this revelation from you. I was serving God, and now all of a sudden, I'm in Egypt. Here I find myself." And so we pick it back up in chapter 39. And it says, "When Joseph was taken to Egypt by the Ishmaelite traders, he was purchased by Potiphar, an Egyptian officer. Potiphar was captain of the guard of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt." And so Potiphar was a very rich man, very influential. It says, "The Lord was with Joseph, so he succeeded in everything he did and served in the home of his Egyptian master." Potiphar noticed this and realized that the Lord was with Joseph, giving him success in everything he did. This pleased Potiphar, so soon Potiphar made Joseph his personal attendant. He put him in charge of his entire household and everything he owned. From the day Joseph was put in charge of his master's household and property, the Lord began to bless Potiphar's house for Joseph's sake. All his household's affairs ran smoothly, and his crops and livestock flourished. So Potiphar gave Joseph complete administration responsibility over everything he owned. With Joseph there, he didn't worry about a thing except what food to eat. I mean, Joseph had it going on. And this is what I love about Joseph. In the whole story of Joseph, Joseph doesn't let his adversity determine his faithfulness to God. See, so often it's tempting to let your adversity determine how faithful you're going to be, how you're going to serve. But we see in the Word that God was with Joseph and God made him successful. And what we can know about God's timing is, when we're waiting, when we are obedient, God will still be with us through it all. So Joseph had it going on. He had one problem. Verse 7. Joseph was very handsome and a well-built young man. I mean, his gym game was strong. He had it going on. His gym game was so strong that it got him in a bind. Check this out. Verse 7, and Potiphar's wife, it's fixing to get real, soon began to look at him lustfully. "Come and sleep with me," she demanded. So you got your gym game going strong. I mean, some of your brothers asking you, "Dude, why aren't you working out?" Well, the Word says don't lead anybody to stumble. I just can't get them girls lusting over me, all right? My gym game too strong. Got to keep that shirt on when I swim, okay? Potiphar's wife lusting after him. So he's got it going on. We go from getting sold into slavery. Now we got it going on. Now we have more adversity. Check this out. But Joseph refused. "Look," he told her, "my master trusts me with everything in his entire household. No one here has more authority than I do. He has held back nothing from me except you, because you are his wife. How could I do such a wicked thing? It would be a great sin against God." And this is another side note, but I think it's important. Check out who he said it would be a great sin against. it would be a great sin against God. And what we got to know that certain sins in our life, if we excuse it for, if he just said, man, it would be a great sin against Potiphar, which it would, or it'd be a great sin against you, or it would be a great sin against me, when you're in the heat of the moment, when we have excuses like that, when we don't see the big picture about, actually, this is about God. This isn't about two people doing what they want to do in a lustful moment. This is about God. Those excuses will never hold up. You can always excuse something away. But when it's for God, when you realize I'm not sinning, this isn't my body. I was bought with a price. I can't do what I want with it. It would be a sin against God. You're held to a higher standard. Know that when we sin, it's not what we do what we want with our own body. It's against God, and he knew that, and that kept him accountable. Verse 10, she kept putting more pressure on Joseph day after day, but he refused to sleep with her. He kept out of her way as much as possible. One day, however, no one else was around. When he went in to do his work, she came and grabbed him by his cloak. This chick was crazy. Demanding, come and sleep with me. Joseph tore himself away, but he left his cloak in her hand as he ran out of the house. It just got real. And the verses say that she accused him of trying to sleep with her. And we find that Potiphar gets furious. He throws Joseph in prison again. And you can just see Joseph thinking, and that was me. Really, God? Really? I'm serving you. God, you're blessing me. I don't even sleep with this girl. Nobody would know about it. And now I'm in prison for it. And what I want you to know, it says, Potiphar was furious when he heard his wife's story about how Joseph had treated her. So he took Joseph and threw him into prison where the king's prisoners were held. And there he remained. Verse 21. But the Lord was with Joseph in prison and showed him his faithful love. When you're operating in God's timing, what you got to know is God will draw you to him. When you're operating in God's timing, we got to know it's going to test your faith, but it will draw you to him if you let it. It says God was with them the whole time, even through it. Even if healing isn't it happening like you think it should, God's going to draw you to him through it. I mean, that adversity didn't make any sense worldly. I mean, if you were serving God just so God would bless you, this story makes zero sense. It would only make sense if nothing bad ever happened to him, but every time he served God faithfully, he still ran into adversity. Why? What we got to know is your faithfulness to God isn't determined by whether or not bad things happen to you, because bad things do happen to good people. You can be in God's perfect will and something go down. And what's interesting is Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 experiences this very thing. And I feel like this is important for us to know. God will draw you to him. And check this out. In 2 Corinthians 12, Paul is defending his ministry. He is defending his apostleship, whether or not he's an apostle, because people were doubting it. And check this out. This is verse 5, and he's talking about experiences that he's had with God. And it says, verse 5, it says, I don't want anyone to give me credit beyond what they can see in my life and hear in my message, even though I have received such wonderful revelations from God. So to keep me from becoming proud, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger from Satan to torment me and keep me from becoming proud. Verse 8. Three different times I begged the Lord to take it away. Each time he said, my grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. And what's crazy to me is, isn't this the same Paul that healed hundreds of people? You look in Acts 19, the word says that God was working so miraculously through Paul that they would touch handkerchiefs to them and go put it on sick people and they'd be healed and demons would run out of them. And here we see Paul going through adversity, begging God to heal him, and God says no. Begging God to heal him, and God says no. And what Paul says is this: now I'm glad to boast about my weakness so that the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weakness and the insults, hardships, persecutions, and troubles that I suffer for Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. And my question to you is this: could it be that the thing you're praying for God to get out of your life is the very thing preparing you for the next step? Could it be that the thing you're begging God to get out of your life, God, heal me of this thing. Why is it not happening? God, heal my finances. God, do something in my life. You're begging him to do it. And for some reason, the Word of God says, ask and you shall receive. Paul knew. Paul wrote that in his Word. If you ask and you shall receive, you'll be healed. I mean, Paul healed, but for him it wasn't happening. And could it be that God had a different plan and it wasn't God's timing quite yet to get him out of it? Why? Because there was something in Paul that might could take him out if God would have gave him right then what he was asking for. And that's pride. Think about it. He said, I was given a thorn in my flesh to keep me from becoming proud. You know it was pride that cast Satan out of heaven? Think about that. He was the most beautiful angel in all of heaven, and that wasn't good enough. And he said, I want to be like God. And as a mature believer, see, God loved Paul so much that he said, I know you're asking for this. And what is interesting about Paul is Paul knew the power of prayer. Because if Paul didn't know, he wouldn't have asked three times. God told him the first time, my grace is all you need. And Paul said, he's a God of mercy. Surely he'll take this away from me. And he prayed it again. And God said, no, my grace is all you need for now. And he said, God, take it away from me. And God said, no, my grace is all you need. And then Paul matured to the place where he realized, God, it's not by my strength, but by Christ's power that I can do this. And it drew, it didn't weaken Paul's faith. It made it stronger. It made it a testimony. And I'm just saying, there's certain times in your life, God will give you a healing right then. God will take something away from you right then. We believe in the power of prayer, but there's certain things that maybe if God gave it to you right now, your character couldn't keep you there. Maybe if God gave you the success you were asking for right now, or the thing you were asking for right now, it wouldn't be the thing that was best for you. And so I want you to know about God's timing. Sometimes you don't get what you ask for because God knows best. And if you let it, it will draw you to him. It will make you stronger. I have, don't let impatience draw you to disobedience. Let waiting draw you to God. Don't let impatience, because this is what happens. A lot of times, it doesn't happen like we think it should. And we get impatient and we roll out on God. Well, if God isn't going to do this for me, then he ain't worth serving. And we roll out. And God, if we would have just waited a little bit, God would have had a powerful work in our lives. He had a purpose that he was molding you. He was preparing for you to do something. And we couldn't trust him enough, because the underlying ingredient for being able to wait on God is trust. We couldn't trust him enough, and it drew us to disobedience before he could bring us to perfection. And I wanted to encourage you, don't let impatience, don't let the fact that God might not be taking you exactly where you want to be right now, immediately, draw you to disobedience. Let waiting draw you to God, because that's what he wants to happen. And he did it in Joseph's life. And we see, I'm going to flip back to Genesis 39, we see he's in prison. Joseph is put in prison for something he didn't do. But it says God was with him. It says God was with him the whole time. God showed his love to Joseph. Not only did he do that, but it says, and the Lord made Joseph a favorite with the prison warden. Before long, the warden put Joseph in charge of all the other prisons and over everything that happened in the prison. The warden had no more worries because Joseph took care of everything. The Lord was with him and caused everything he did to succeed. You know that in your prison, a lot of times, your prison isn't your prison, it's your place of preparation. Your prison isn't your prison, it's your place of preparation. You see, and what did he do? In the prison, it is so, God, why? Why aren't you taking me to the place? Because I'm preparing you. I'm preparing you. Verse 40 talks about how he has an opportunity to interpret two dreams for people. It was the chief cupbearer and the chief chef. And these people had dreams. And check this out. I want you to look at the difference in Joseph's attitude at this point as opposed to when he was 17 years old. The men have two dreams that they want him to interpret. And Joseph says, chapter 8, they replied, "We both had dreams last night, but no one can tell us what they mean." Joseph said, "Interpreting dreams is God's business." Joseph replied, "Go ahead and tell me your dreams." There's an interesting change because when he was talking to his brothers and his parents, he said it in a way, it was all about him. Look at what God was doing for me. And right now we see a change in attitude, a maturity in faith. Interpreting dreams is God's business, and it's only by God's power because God was molding him. Chapter 40 talks about he interprets those dreams. There was the chief chef that had a dream basically that was about the fact that he would be in 3 days executed. There was a dream that the chief cupbearer had that was basically about the fact that the Egyptian king, Pharaoh, was going to restore him to his place. And Joseph said, "When you go to Pharaoh and you're restored, remember me and tell Pharaoh, you know, to see my case so I can get out of jail." And it says, Pharaoh impaled the chief baker. He executed the chief baker. But as Joseph predicted, Pharaoh's chief cupbearer, however, forgot all about Joseph, never giving him another thought. 2 full years later, Pharaoh dreamed that he was standing on the bank of the Nile. And in his dream, he saw 7 fat, healthy cows come up out of the river. And what's interesting to me, 2 years later, so God gives him this vision at 17. He gets sold into Egypt. He has the success. Then he goes to prison. He fulfills. He has it. He's matured. He tells these people their dreams. And still God doesn't work for 2 years later. 2 years later. And then Pharaoh has a dream. And what's interesting to me, think about it. What do you think God was doing in Joseph for 2 years in prison? He already told us Joseph was in charge of everything that the prison guard was in charge of. He ran all the people. He ran all the everything in the prison. God gave him success. Pharaoh's going to have a dream. Long story short, he has a dream that they're going to have 7 years, 7 prosperous years, and 7 years of famine. And Joseph comes through. We see in verse 16. Joseph again gives God the glory. He's pulled out of prison to interpret the dream. He says, "It is beyond my power to do this, but God can tell you what it means and set you at ease." And he tells Pharaoh the dream. What's going to happen? There's going to be 7 years of prosperity, and there's going to be 7 years of famine. And what you need to do is hold back 1/5 of all the crops from the prosperous years so you can have grain. And Pharaoh obviously follows the idea and puts Joseph in charge of everything. And so from chapter 40 all the way to chapter 45, we see the story of Joseph doing the hard work. He was prepared in the prison. That was his preparation stage to do what God had called him to do. And we see the famine happens, and Joseph's brothers come to him in Egypt to buy grain. And we see at the end of chapter 45 that God has restored the vision that he gave to Joseph in the beginning, 15 years later. And check out Joseph's perspective on all this. Now think about it. He's been back and forth and all over the place in God's timing for 15 years. You might have a message from God, we want it done tomorrow. We're mad because my McDouble at McDonald's was 30 seconds late. And Joseph waited 15 years, and this is his perspective when he finally meets his brothers and reveals his identity. Check this out. He says, this is chapter 45, verse 4. He said again, I am Joseph, your brother whom you sold into slavery in Egypt. But don't be upset. Don't be angry with yourself for selling me to this place. What? How many of y'all would be angry if your brother sold you into slavery? We were going to kill you, but instead of that, we just sold you into slavery. 15 years later, Joseph has come to the place where he says, now that my perspective has changed, don't even be mad about that. Why? Don't be upset. Don't be angry with yourselves. It was God who sent me here ahead of you to preserve your lives. This famine has ravaged the land for 2 years, and it will last 5 more years, and there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. God sent me ahead of you to keep you and your families alive and preserve many survivors. So it was God who sent me here, not you. He is the one who made me an advisor to Pharaoh, the manager of his entire palace, and the governor of all of Egypt. Now think about that. It was God who did all that. And you could go rebuking Satan for sending you to Egypt, and you could go rebuking Satan for Potiphar's wife messing you over and getting you thrown in prison, and you could go rebuking Satan for all that, and you might be serving God perfectly. And what I want to give us the perspective is that God's timing, not only will it test your faith, not only will it draw you closer to Him, but God's timing is perfect. God's timing is perfect. The prison was necessary. It prepared Joseph for being able to handle the whole kingdom of Egypt. Because Joseph was sold into slavery, a thing that was terrible, a thing that didn't make sense, a thing that we would pray, God, take me out of. Because that happened, the whole land of Egypt and the whole nation of Israel was preserved. And what I'm here to tell you today is, often God makes us wait to prepare us, but what we got to know is God's timing is perfect, and He has this under control, and it's preparing you. And what I want to encourage you in is, stop asking why and start asking what now. Stop asking why, God, and start asking what now, God. When you can have the attitude of, I'm going to stop asking why, I'm not going to stop praying, I'm not going to stop asking God to do things, but when I'm serving God, I know I'm serving God, adversity hits, the stuff is going down, I'm not going to sit here and cry, why, God? I'm going to sit and say, God, what now? How can I grow in this situation? How can I operate in your timing? Because what we got to know is the word. And 2 Peter chapter 3 says, do not overlook this one fact, that with the Lord, one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill His promises, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. And what God is asking us today is, do you trust me enough to be obedient when you have to wait? Because it's easy when you're spurring down lunatic fringe. I mean, when your relationship with God is going like that, I saw a thing on Facebook, Fluff shared it, I thought it was pretty sweet. There was a guy stuck in standstill traffic, which is terrible. I hate traffic. I lose my Jesus sometimes over traffic, especially when I'm headed to a rodeo, cowboy land time. And this guy, he's filming, he's been in standstill traffic for an hour, and there's cars coming by him, just easy as they please, and they're just stacked up here. And he's talking about how so often, man, sometimes our walk with God is like this. There's traffic going by, and sometimes our walk with God is like, you feel like I'm in standstill traffic. God, I'm serving you, and nothing is going right. I'm not where I feel like I should be. And if you're not careful, you'll be bitter at all the people you see going by, spurring down lunatic fringe, you won't be happy for him, and you will miss the lesson that God is doing in your life. You'll miss the thing that he's preparing for you in your life. And God is asking you, do you trust me enough to be obedient? Three things. His timing is going to test your faith. His timing is going to draw you to him. And just know, his timing is perfect. When we know God's timing is perfect, as long as I'm being obedient to him, I'm doing the things of God, I can trust him. We know God is sovereign. You can actually have peace in the prison because you know it's preparing you. You can have peace in the hard times because you know what it's doing in your life. And I just wanted to ask you today, do you trust God enough to be obedient as he's preparing you and making you wait on God's timing? Because when we do, we'll have the fruit of his spirit develop in our life. And that's what it's all about. So remember those three things. God's timing is going to test your faith. It's going to draw you to him if we let it. And his timing is perfect. His timing is perfect. Y'all bow your heads with me. Father God, Lord, we just thank you, Father, for your word, God, for examples in your word, God, that, Lord, we can just know sometimes when things aren't going our way, sometimes when life isn't panning out quite like we thought it would, God, Lord, if we're being obedient to you, God, we can trust your timing, God. Lord, God, you're rarely early, but you're never late. God, your word says, those who trust, those who wait on the Lord, Father, will be fulfilled, God. And we can know, God, that you have our back. God, you're worth trusting. God, if we're going to operate on your timing, we have to trust you enough to be obedient in it, to not try to make it happen on our own. And I just pray that, you, God, you would mature us to a place to know that your timing is perfect, that you have your will in mind, your will for our lives in mind, and your will for our lives is better than anything we could ever imagine or ask for. And so I just pray that you give us boldness to serve you, God, even when it doesn't make sense and even when we have to wait. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right.
Thank you for joining us today. We hope you enjoyed our service. If you're looking for fertile ground to sow into, we would love to have you be a part of Branded for Christ. Until next week, go out and be blessed.